It's not about 2019. It's about 2050. And if you don't want this thing, this lifestyle, this habit in 2050, then why do you need it in 2019?
Hold up. What up, vlog? We're here in the mobile office. It's the new year. Welcome. So everyone's talking about resolutions, how to get your resolutions, how to lose weight, how to gain weight, how to bulk up, how to fatten your bank account, whatever it is. We're not talking about that. What we're talking about is the intersection between meaningful work and progress. Now, I think the whole thing around resolutions or a new beginning has everything to do with progress. Everything that we do really is, how do we unlock meaningful work? How do we create meaningful work? How do we find meaningful work in frustrating situations? Because what happens when we have this meaningful work, if I say meaningful work one more time, just slap me, meaningful work. But if we have this meaningful work, what it does for us as a human being is it begins to unleash an unfair advantage. It gives us, the human being, this aspect of our existence, a whole new level of living, a whole new level of energy, excitement, engagement. Number one, pick one thing, just one thing, and don't put all these parameters around it. Don't make it so big, because here's the thing. In 2016, throughout all of 2016, I decided, actually it would have been 2017. It was 2017. Out of all of 2017, I decided every day I was gonna do yoga. And I think as we've said, I did maybe about 75% of the days, I completed some type of yoga. I put no parameters around it. I didn't say how long it was gonna happen, and I couldn't put all of these details and saying, by June, I'm gonna be a yogi. No. But every day for 75% of the days of 2017, I essentially got down on the floor and did some type of yoga. Therefore, there was an incredibly positive impact and something that has in many ways carried through a large portion of my life. I've allowed the habit developed in that year to kind of spill into now, as we're in 2019, still be something that's incorporated in my life. I would say that getting into yoga, stretching, opened the door to deep breathing, which then opened the door to more of a meditation practice, which opened the door to more clarity, more of a mental health habit in my life. And so here's number one of how we begin the process, the strategy. I'm not telling you this is the only strategy. I'm just saying it gets complicated when we get a lot of things in place. And to make progress, we need to pick one thing. Since the beginning of resolutions, we have a repeatable pattern that we're used to. And this pattern is that come a new year, we have a new beginning. With that new year and new beginning, what happens is excitement comes along with it. We are excited for something new. We are excited for something fresh or big. Same thing's true. Like, you get a new house, you get a new car, you get a new watch, you get some new clothes. Like, anything that comes with, anything that is new oftentimes brings excitement. And what's happening internally is that newness creates dopamine in the brain. And so part of why resolutions or a new thing, which a resolution is just something that we have grown up in this environment, where it's like, hey, it's this time of year, have a resolution, it's a new beginning, you can finally get to it, and our brain begins to flood with dopamine. And number two is this: there's some junk in your trunk. What I mean by this is, there's some things that gotta go. When we are looking at making daily progress, stepping forth on a new venture, one of the things that happened, the thing that happens is we add in new habits, new ideas, new things we're going to practice, new things we're going to do, but what we never do is drop anything off. So we fill up the car, but we still got all the junk in the trunk. So what needs to get deleted? Is it a certain habit? Is it a way of thinking? I know for me, I ask myself the question, what no longer serves me? And so I had to decide to put some parameters. So even for me, for example, for this year, one of the things I'm implementing is this. No email, and no, there's certain type of articles I like to read, and no social media unless I am actively going on to post something before 11 a.m. And so that way now my phone, when I wake up in the morning, there's nothing I really need to be doing other than maybe going and reading something that's encouraging to me, reading a set of affirmations, reading a plan for the day, reading a letter. And so that's it. You gotta make space for something. I don't know about you, but this thing has this, you could probably show this thing. Yeah, this thing right here. It's a beautiful tool, but this thing also can take up our mental capacity so fast. I don't know about you, but I get on an elevator, I'm walking somewhere, I am pulling out my phone and looking at something. That tool is powerful and it helps you stay plugged in. But that's the problem, is you could stay so totally plugged in and connected to everything that you never reach the moment of clarity or the moment of silence, which allows us to then create some mental space, some mental capacity. And so part of this daily progress is creating space by deleting. We have to get stuff out. I realize if I am going to step into a new version of me, I mean, I get caught up in the resolutions just like you, but I'm trying to say now what needs to come out. If I'm gonna forge forth, I'm gonna create something new, what has to come out? Whether or not, let's just say your resolution is to lose 20 pounds. This time of year, right now, today's January 4th, 5th, 6th, whatever, 3rd, 2nd, I don't know. I don't know what day it is. Right now, you could be sitting down with full resolution intention of wanting to lose weight. You could be sitting down eating a hamburger and 2 donuts, yet your brain is still flooding with dopamine thinking this time of year is amazing because I have a resolution and I'm gonna take a new action. But your brain is flooded with the dopamine of excitement because of the pattern of the newness. I'm repeating myself. The point is, this time of year is a very dangerous, tricky time because we feel progress regardless of whether progress is happening or not. And that is why so many of us miss out on our resolutions. Now, pushing aside resolutions, progress. You know what? Let's stay on resolutions for a minute. We're here. You suckered me in. Number 3 is this. Daily progress is not for 2019. Your resolution should not be for 2019. Your resolution should be for the rest of your life.
Forever, 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 ever, forever, ever.
Years ago, I had a mentor ask me, Josh, how long do you want to be in business for? And I think at the time I was maybe 26, 27. We were on the phone and I was expressing an incredible bit of frustration that I had about something in specific. And you know, I want to live to 120, and so I said like let's say 70 years. She goes, okay, so you want to be in business for another 70 years because I personally don't want to retire. He goes, if it took you 2 years to work through this problem and you had then 68 good years afterwards, would that be worth it? I don't know the math on that, but let's say like, what is that? 7 would be 10, half of 7 is 3.5. We're talking like 2%. Would 2%, well, it's gotta be more than 2, would 3% of the time be worth it to get the breakthrough, to get the approach that you want? And I'm like, hell yes, it would be. The problem with a resolution, the problem with an outcome is we need it, we want it now. If it's something that's so important that we would begin to reorient our life, we have to begin to say, I need this the rest of my life. I don't just need it right now. I need it forever. That's the thing, like, do I need it right now? Do I not need it right now? I don't know. But do I need it next year? When I truly become the person that I want to be, when I'm truly in the role that I want to be in, when I'm living the life that I really see for myself, this daily progress needs to be something that I need for the long run. This time of year, dopamine's flooding our system. But then we are also getting focused on outcomes. So I make a change the first week of January. I lose a few pounds. I'm getting excited. This starts to get thinner. These go in a little bit. Your eyes become more prominent. You see that jawline again. Pants maybe fit a little bit looser. You're like, these are good things. You're focused on the outcomes. Then what happens is about the middle of January or 10 days, and that dopamine starts to dry up because it's no longer the beginning of the year. The newness of this has worn away. And because we got focused on an outcome, all of a sudden, if that doesn't continue to get thinner or these don't go in anymore, then we start to get frustrated. And so here's what happened. Just track with me for a second. We had dopamine, so we were excited. Whether we're eating donuts or we're eating kale, we're feeling good. We make a couple positive changes, and so we like to see the result. We see the outcome. And then, let's just say 2 weeks later, the dopamine has dried up. All of a sudden, the progress slows, or maybe we plateau. And the two things we were focused on, well, the dopamine we weren't focused on, we didn't know it was happening, but it's gone. And the progress, the outcome, is gone. And now we're like, screw it, I'm out. Because we had no infrastructure for what's next. I think why progress really matters, which I've probably said that a couple of times, is because we want progress because we desire to move forward in something, lose weight, project at work, whatever. If it was so easy to do, we would have already done it. So I think we need a new approach, a new way of thinking. And that's where daily progress comes in. But I'm talking about the most micro of daily progress. If you're saying, I'm gonna eat better, what does that mean? I'm gonna go to the gym 5 days a week. I'm gonna work out really long on the weekend. I'm gonna do a marathon by June. It's like you've built this huge mountain of expectation on yourself. And it's like, how do you even begin to make daily progress on that? And maybe you're really good. And maybe you break it all the way down and you got a spreadsheet and you chart this whole thing out and you know the 19 things you gotta do every day. And come January 4th, you're exhausted. And you're exhausted because you've spent all of this time, the dopamine starting to wear off because you're like, son of a, this is a lot of work. Yeah. And I'm sure there are some of you out there who are freaks of nature who can do that and you dial it all the way down and you've got that mindset. But for the 99% of us in the world who aren't like that, daily progress, small seeds. Number four is this. Efficiency of time, almost like time stacking, thinking about things differently. What I mean by efficiency of time is this. Let's take for example, working out. If you're 50% efficient with working out, you go to the gym and you've got a little bit of a plan and you do something. And you know what? Going to the gym on a 50% efficiency commitment level is heck of a lot better than zero. But if you take that same 50% and all of a sudden you show up to the gym with a 75% efficiency level, meaning the moment you walk into the gym, you are hitting it hard. You've got a plan, you've got a process, you've got a system. Your outcome on the 50%, let's say it's a level 10, a level 10 outcome. But if you go with that 75% efficiency of time commitment, you might get a level 30 or a level 40 outcome. But what if instead of 50 or 75, what if you show up with 100% efficiency in that moment? I mean, you are running into the gym. You are ready. You've got a plan on your phone. You've already got your mind attuned to the exercises. You've already run through it mentally on your drive to the gym.
Excuse me, sir, you have to check in.
Not now, chief, I'm in the zone.
So by the time you show up, you are not, there is no guessing what you're doing. And all of a sudden, with that time, you are 100% committed, 100% efficient. Do you get a level 70, a level 80, level 90, level 100 outcome? I mean, I know this is as a theory, but when we can tune in our efficiency to the moment of what we're doing, we can go harder in that moment, in that thing, all of a sudden we start to get the outcome. Now, I know I said focus on your efforts, but outcomes feel good too. We're fighting against that dopamine drop off that happens in that first 2 to 3 weeks of the new year.
when we can get excited about our efforts and then start to get some outcomes,
woo,
that becomes powerful. But one of the things that I have wanted to work into my schedule is this, being a little bit more present with my kids. So how I can work in efficiency of time. Last night, great example, I am feeding the kids dinner, my wife's out, and I walk past Brooklyn, and normally I would have just kept on walking, but I just stopped, put my hand on her shoulder, and I said something along the lines of like, I really enjoyed getting to be with you today, and just took like a moment to connect with her, even if it only felt like a connection to me. And you know what happened? She stopped what she was doing, eating, looked up at me and said, Dad, will you sit down next to me? Sure, yeah, I'll sit down next to you. Now, normally I would have just kept on walking. I don't know what I would have done. Probably wasn't that important because I was working on getting dinner, get the kids to bed. But I used efficiency of time. It's tough to become the best version of ourselves. It's tough to truly see this resolution come into place. The problems are the dopamine's gonna dry up and we're so focused on outcomes. And if we do that, it's probably just gonna be another year of, I mean, I don't even dare say frustration because we just laugh. Oh, resolutions, I gave up on that a long time ago. But if you can begin to incorporate some of these elements into your life, number one, focusing on just one thing. You know, come May, come June, come April, add on another thing or make it more complex. It's fine. To say that I'm gonna do some type of physical activity 3 times a day or once a week or once a day, that doesn't mean you gotta hit the treadmill for 60 minutes. It means you could do 5 sit-ups, 5 push-ups, and 5 squats. Like, you know, you could do that in the elevator if nobody's in there. Number two, delete. You gotta take some things out. You gotta get rid of that junk in the trunk. Number three, make it for 2050. You know, it's not about 2019, it's about 2050. And if you don't want this thing, this lifestyle, this habit in 2050, then why do you need it in 2019? And lastly, gotta be more efficient with our time. Gotta find the way to make the most out of the time. Oh, hey, forgot to say goodbye. Thanks so much for your attention. Meaningful work is so important. It's so valuable to who we are as humans, which over the next 10, 20 years in the workplace becomes so critical that we live in alignment with who we are best. But part of meaningful work is the intersection of meaningful work and progress, the feeling of winning, the surge of momentum. And I do believe that taking some of these steps forward creates it in our personal life, in our work life, which is who we are as a human. It's both of these things. Thank you again so much for your attention. Looking forward to next week for episode 30. See you then. Bye.